Welcome, welcome. We are back for another episode of The Lock-In. I am David Lappin. I am joined, as usual, by Dara O'Kearney. Dara, it is Irish Open week.
Is it? Really?
For fuck's sake, Dara, play along. Yes, it's Irish Open week. Okay. Maybe I have to make a confession here. This is a pre-recorded episode, and the reason for that will become apparent in a moment's time. But let's assume that it's Irish Open week for the moment, Dara. I noticed you are the bookies' favourite to win the tournament. It must be that rich vein of form you're in.
Joint favourite, it has to be.
I was going
to
say, joint favourite. Hello.
Joint favourite with our guest.
Pipe down guest who hasn't been introduced yet.
Joint favourite with our guest and a bunch of other poker players who are a lot better than me. Like, shout out to Dominic Nietzsche, for example, and Steve O'Dwyer, who has actually won this tournament, as opposed to me, who's barely ever even cashed it. It's the bookie odds always cause a bit of laughter every year they come out. Everybody who. This is the first year where I'm. Can claim to be pretty happy with the odds. Every year people are generally talking about how terrible the odds are, but really what they mean is their own price is too high and they should be much lower, much more highly rated than the bookies do. They're all terrible prices, it has to be said. The number's likely to be 2,500. So quoting 150-1 on somebody, even somebody as willing to fire as many bullets as me and Firaldo, is pretty optimistic.
Well, joining us, in case you're incredibly stupid in joint favouritism this week with Dara, is this week's guest. He is a triple crown winner and the creator of the Irish Open Leaderboard. Going to have to ask him about that in a moment. He is also, more importantly, the star of the fantastic Greg Clark directed BBC documentary, The Four Rules of the Poker Kings, which is on the BBC iPlayer as of tomorrow, because we're putting this out the day before. Niall Farrell, welcome back to The Lock-In.
How are you doing, guys? Thanks for having me.
Neil, it's great to have you back on. I'm just thinking now, how cool would it be if one of us actually does win the Irish Open and this is actually put out months from now? It will have been
that would be cool. I mean, I'm much more pessimistic. I'm like, it'd be quite funny if I get hit by a bus before it went out and you have to fucking weekend it Bernie's me into the interview. But
sorry, but you're always drawing dead in the Irish Open because I presume at some point in the middle of the tournament there's a Celtic match, which means you'll just disappear.
Yeah, well, that's what I was saying. It's in joint favourite. I think I'm 150-1. I think that might just be the price to be there on time. Like, I don't know if it's to win it. Maybe save your 15 pence max bets on that, I think. I think this time there's a... It's not a Celtic Rangers game this time, so I might just go for the old phone at the table professional route, you know?
Oh, yeah, very professional. Neil, we bring you back very much with your documentary in mind. But before we get to that, can we talk a little bit about the Irish Open leaderboard? At the time of recording, the Irish Open is almost upon us and we are not 100% sure of the transmission date of the documentary, except that the show will go out the day before. You posted this tweet about the Irish Open leaderboard about a week ago or so and hyped it up on social media in the run-up to the festival. What exactly will this entail, or did it entail?
So, I kind of was having a look. I remember there used to be kind of leaderboards for Irish Open before in previous years, if I'm right, because I used to have little bets on them and stuff, because, you know, it's fun. And I know I asked this year if they had one. I wasn't sure if there was one, and I was informed there wasn't an official one. So I decided, being the organisational genius that I am, I'm sure this will all go with no problems whatsoever. It will be the cleanest launch of any leaderboard in history. But I decided I'm just going to run one for morale, because it feels like it's a kind of stop, you know, it's a destination stop. It should have some kind of, you know, leaderboard for everyone that's playing every day and having fun and stuff. So I decided just to run my own. And I'm going to, and again, I'm going in pretty blind. This is the inaugural Firaldo Irish Open leaderboard. So I was thinking, I had a lot of logistical issues to think about, so I'm trying to think ahead. So I've decided it's just going to be done on most caches in the side events up until the Friday. So it's the Monday till the Friday. And then the top four contestants will go through to a non-poker final, which I've tried to base off the things I love about the Irish Open. So number one, drinking, sadly. So we're going to have a Guinness Split the G competition. I'm sure, obviously, I won't have to explain what that is to you, but maybe you can for people who are watching. The non-alcoholic Guinness is available, of course. And also gambling, which I think I'm going to do a fantasy horse race. We're all going to get a horse race on the TV, We're going to give all the contestants 10 euros, the four guys, 40 euro outlay. This is the kind of commitment I have to this leaderboard. And the winner is the one who wins the most money or loses the least money. The best play might not to be bet at all. But anyway, and the final one is the crack, which I'm informed that there is karaoke on the Saturday night. So we will. I'm excited to hear people singing for the grand prize at the end. So that's the rough outline. As always, you know, the organizers' decisions are final, so good luck with that. But yes, that is the rough outline.
No, that sounds like terrific fun, I got to say. Dara, I'm sure everyone can imagine you faring well in the unfelt activities, but they might be surprised at how well you could do in the off-the-felt stuff, splitting the G. We've mentioned it before on this show, so we don't have to go into too many details, but you have beaten Niall in a drinking contest before. It is also a fact that you and I came second in a massively prestigious beer pong contest at the Dublin UK IPT 2 years ago. So what do you make of Niall's contest?
In the biggest upset since David versus Goliath, I did actually manage to beat Niall. I think the venue was Berlin, and the witnesses included Jennifer Shahade and Kenny Shea. The thing is, like, when anything's competitive, I immediately set my mind to it. Like, as soon as Niall mentioned the horse racing thing, my mind was like, well, if you were one of the four people, what's the best strategy? And my first impression is just bet on the favorite. You're obviously most likely to win. But it does remind me of, and you might remember this too, David, years ago, we tried to liven up the Irish Open in a similar way. And we had a prop bet with another prominent crew in Irish poker at the time. Quite a lot of money was bet on both sides as to which of our squad of six or their squad of six would cash for the most in the Irish Open. And it came down to none of us actually cashing. It just completely and utterly fizzled down. In fact, it was particularly sad. I remember it came down to the five of us railing Colin Hammond as he tried to get two big blinds through the bubble. So we would win this big side bet, which was far more important than him min cashing. And unfortunately, he wasn't able to do it. So, yeah, that's always the danger when you introduce that element of variance, let's say.
Well, look, I think it's going to be great fun, or was great fun, as the case may be. Yep. No stranger to creative flights of fancy like this one, Niall, but you also came up with a fantastic idea, which you tweeted out a few months back. I believe you were following Joanne Liu's progress in her poker challenge across Canada, and you came up with a fantastic idea, Hendon Mob flag-inspired amazing race. Can you explain this one for us?
Yeah, I know, I'm great at coming up with daft ideas here, but no, I was just thinking, seeing the Joanne Liu one, I'm not a big poker content guy or anything, but I do have like kind of some ideas, and I really like the Joanne Liu one, where it's basically allows like you to follow the lifestyle of the poker player around, and it's like not just here I am playing cash, I won this amount, this is my hands, you know. So this one was a race, so it's basically a kind of rip off of the Amazing Race, where you get competitors get dropped in a country. I think I originally said Romania, and they have to make it back across Europe, however they can, to back to the UK. But they are not allowed to skip a country, so you have to, you know, go to a country that's bordering the next country, and you can plot your own route, so you can figure out what the best way to do is. But you're not allowed to leave that country until you've cashed a poker tournament in that country. So I think a lot of it would be fun, like trying to find, like, you know, there's not much poker content of like, here I am in a Slovenian bar playing the local nightly tournament to try and cash so I can move on to a different country, you know, and stuff like that. And I think it really like would allow you to get a lot of like interaction and content from like the kind of grassroots poker stuff. Because, you know, like I play in like these pub games and stuff with my brother at home, and it's a lot of fun, but these are all guys that will never really, or not yet, haven't really gone to like any like poker festivals and stuff like that. So maybe it's like a little bridge to get them involved and stuff like that. So I thought it'd be quite fun. And I did, like, there's nothing I used to love, like just living out a suitcase and traveling from country to country back in the day. So why not combine the both?
No, it's a fantastic idea. I had two thoughts on this one, actually. I remember when I first read it, which one was, I thought it would be really fun if it was done in pairs and both people had to cash, because it would create some great conflict between those two people. I can imagine Dara and I stuck in Romania, him going, just cash the fucking bowl, Comte. I've cashed it a week ago. We need to get out of here. And then secondly, I thought, you know, can you do what you described there, where you go to like a pub game, but you have to get it on the Hendon Mob? So now you're like bribing Hans or Roland to like make sure it's Hendon Mobable.
Just letting them, yeah, I'd have to speak to them. There's a lot of logistical stuff. So I'd have to speak to them beforehand, asking them to put them on. And also, like, it would need to be, I think I would need to do a dry run as well. So, like, because I mean, imagine you just don't cash a tournament for, and you're stuck in Romania for 7 weeks or something. You know, it's like not the ideal start. So I would need to see how that would do. So I need to maybe do a dry run of it as well. But yeah, there's been a lot of, I chatted about it with a few people in at EPT Paris about logistics and stuff. So we'll see if we can get it. It's more complicated than just coming up with the idea, obviously, but I'd be quite interested to see if we could make it happen.
Yeah, I can't imagine any run you doing being dry, but anyway, we'll move on. I was talking to David Curtis, actually. Maybe you spoke to him as well at EPT Paris, PokerStars' new PR guy, obviously. And he said he loved the idea. Has he or anyone else approached you to actually do this?
I had a talk with David. He does like the idea. We talked about it in Paris. The Hendon Mob offered a package to their South African event for the winner as well, but there's been no concrete, like I haven't fleshed out the idea or anything. David was pretty interested in it as well from a Stars perspective, I believe. But it would need to, so that's what I was doing. I was talking with Mac, who's works with Spraggy and all and Tonka, the film and the kind of media side of things about logistics and stuff. And I was talking with Summer as well, who works with the Poker Stars media team as well, because obviously I'm not a media, you know. I think if I'm an expert in anything, it's making cards match other cards, which is such a poor thing to be an expert in. But like media stuff's not, you know, I have no experience. I've noticed. So I'm just speaking to them about, you know, potential pitfalls and all that kind of stuff. But they seem, Mac especially seemed quite keen to take it on. So hopefully we can do it. I mean, I'm sure I'll be at the Irish Open, or I have already talked to people at the Irish Open, depending on where we are on the timeline in the multiverse at the moment. But yeah, so we'll discuss it further, hopefully.
Yeah, I hope it will be called Niall Farrell's Amazing Race when it
oh, I'm putting my name on everything. I'm yeah, not fucking
for sure. Dara, you and I would have to enter a team in this one, right? If we did, what route would you choose across Europe?
Yeah, I'm currently staring at a map of Europe because they don't teach us this type of stuff in school, or at least they didn't back 70 years ago when I was in school, and a lot of these countries didn't even exist at the time. My first thought was the most direct route was Hungary, Austria, Italy, France, and then you're back to the UK. But the problem there is Hungary. So I just checked on the Hendon Mob, and there's no event scheduled in Hungary for the next 3 months. So I'm guessing that rules out Hungary. It's really annoying that Slovakia almost, but doesn't quite border Romania. You'd have to go through Ukraine, and that doesn't seem like a great idea. So it actually is quite convoluted. I think we'd have to go Bulgaria, Greece, Albania, Montenegro.
Are you going the right way?
What's the answer? Yeah. Unless we can find something in Serbia, that would speed things up. But then, yeah, essentially, by hook or by crook, you have to get to Italy. The final few legs is always going to be Italy, France, and then the UK.
Nice. Okay.
Fucking well, solver's running on it already. You know, come up with an idea, it's solved in about 15 minutes. Fuck's sake.
I also think there should be bonus points for the most creative route. If somebody does sort of go backwards or go, you know, a circuitous way, I think that
the swag of just going through Finland or something, you know.
Yeah.
Well, the other way, yeah. Just go get to Russia quickly and then hop across to the US, because technically it does border the US.
Yeah,
and,
that's a good point. There might be fewer countries in the mix then.
Bonus points for going east.
yeah, I like that. And it might actually be sneakily not as terrible as it sounds.
Well, it'd be less countries for sure.
But more traveling, more sightseeing, which is maybe kind of half the point of this. Anyway, let's get to the four rules of the Poker Kings. First of all, huge congratulations to you, to producer director Greg Clark, I should say, and David Docherty, who also features prominently in this. I have to say, I thoroughly enjoyed it. For anyone who hasn't heard about this yet, the documentary takes place from December 2021 to July 2022, sort of follows Niall around the circus. He goes to Prague, Monte Carlo, Dublin, and Las Vegas. And those sort of trips are interspersed with home life in Dumfries, Scotland. Niall, we're going to show three clips and sort of leap off each one. But before we do, the four poker rules motif gives the story a backbone, if you like, while Clark's narration fleshes out the story, sort of part explainer, part commentary. Were you aware of that desired structure during the filming, or is that something that Greg figured out when he got into the editing suite with all the footage?
So there was kind of, I think Greg had a different idea for the structure at the time. But as is so often with these creative types, it's in flux, you know. So he kind of, as the footage came, he made a lot of changes and stuff. So I think there was going to be a kind of different structure to it at the time, but he's decided to go this way, and it's come out really well, I think. But yeah, the main thing he was saying to me, because, like, you know, as much as Greg learned about poker during this time, I actually, you know, I learned a bit about how things are made, which is quite cool. And he's saying his ideas, he wants it to be, it's not a documentary about poker, it's a documentary about people in poker, and that's what makes it more interesting to people who aren't poker geeks like us, you know. Like, I would watch any documentary with poker in the title, where it's like, you know, I guess that's because this will be on mainstream TV, you know, it'll be on BBC Scotland, it'll be on iPlayer. It needs to appeal to not just people grinding Sims at 4 a.m, you know, it's got to everyone else. So it was important. He made it really clear that he wanted it to be a documentary about myself and David. But to give it, that's how you see about poker through the eyes of, you know, two Scottish guys that play it, you know.
Excellent stuff. Well, speaking of doing Sims till late at night, our first clip, which I'm going to show now, this is Niall in the lab, and then right afterwards it sort of crash cuts to him arriving to Monte Carlo in style.
As there are a near infinite combination of the ways 52 cards can fall, the creation of computer solvers has changed the way today's poker has been played. Whereas in the past it was grit, cigars and psychology, today's game is more about maths, stats and odds.
This is basically your homework, if you want to. There's so many permutations of hands in poker that you can't, you know, you can't sit and learn everything you're meant to do with a 5 and a 4 and then sit and learn everything you're meant to do with a 5 and a 3. So what the solver does is allows you to learn that a lot more quickly, and it can be quite heavy work because it is a bit nerdy, it is a bit, you know, booky. It's not James Bond flopping a royal flush. It's, here's a big load of numbers, learn this if you want money.
It just shows you opponents can have nothing 40% of the time here they're going to have. So just complete dog shit, and they're going to have top pairs, so on. It shows you the different equity shifts and everything. It's so complicated, man, honestly. Like, this is top, top level.
We're 2 days away from Monte Carlo. I'm going to be playing the 5K main event, which is going to be massive. It's the grand final of the European Poker Tour. I'm also playing a €25,000 buy-in tournament there, the high roller at the very end, which will be, it's always quite big in Monte Carlo, because, you know, €25,000 to a Monte Carlo native is like a fucking bag of chips. It's the dream, isn't it? Just nipping over at Monte Carlo, pick up €1 million and head back, you know? Fucking, that'd be class, but got to put the work in first. Poker for me, it's like, it's a ticket out of the rat race, you know. It's like, you need to get up at 7, get dressed, you know, go work a job that you don't really like because you need money for a boss that maybe you don't like, and then it's, you get paid and you go home and then you repeat it, and it's just, I think I would go mental doing that. Fortunately for me, like, I have certain skills that it's got me this ticket out.
Well, as anyone who knows you, Niall, would expect of you as well, you deliver sharp insights and plenty of wit throughout this documentary. There's profundity and profanity in equal measure as you ponder your life's choices, you ruminate on the nature of risk-taking, and you acknowledge how tournament players are always at the mercy of some short-term luck. I think you do a really good job, actually, at showing both sides of poker. The way that some of it is glamorous and excessive, helicopter rides, $500 stakes, but also the less glamorous side as well. In fact, in that clip, juxtaposed right before you swan into Monte Carlo, like a movie star, is the scene of you showing Greg your shark scope graph and then your PO solver explaining the quote-unquote nerdy stuff. Was the both sides thing something that you specifically wanted to get across?
Yeah, so essentially, a lot of Greg was saying a very kind of common and for a reason, not trope, but structure of the documentary is the kind of the hero's journey, which is like overcoming adversity, and then the hero wins at the end. Now, when he explained this to me, I had to say, listen, I know you don't know about poker, but I can't guarantee you I'm going to win fucking anything over this year. I might just lose for a year straight. So it might just be the hero starts off shite and gets shiter for the whole year. And he's like, okay, so we'll try and so we had some kind of backup plans as well for like wins or whatever. Because like essentially, like he says, like the dream is we follow you and then at the end in Vegas you win three bracelets, blah blah blah. But instead I just bricked Vegas for infinite. So he's very, very smart, creative guy. So the win became, well, I have a beautiful girlfriend and son and a great life, I've won at life kind of thing as well. Although I did win some stuff on the way. Actually, we got pretty lucky with the poker stuff because what did I get? I got a 10th, a 16th, and then a win in Dublin, which is well above what you would expect for that small period of time. So we did get very lucky with that stuff. But it was like, I mean, Greg came in completely cold to poker. So I am explaining to him, it's like, there's a very, very high chance that I just lose for this entire documentary, which won't be ideal. But we got pretty lucky, so we're fortunate on that front.
Yeah, no, it worked in a great way. Dara, the other aspect of the both sides of the poker life is the split between the on the road poker grinding that Neil does and then domestic life, as he's alluded to there. Neil's family are very much part of this documentary. Did you enjoy that aspect and how relatable did you find it?
Yeah, I did. Yeah, because a lot of people, when they think of poker players, they think of like some young guy who's completely on his own and has his maybe has his poker crew, but has no life really outside of poker. And there's more and more people like myself and Neil, and yourself as well. You obviously have a young family too, who sort of, it's our job. And the stuff that people see is the stuff that we do in poker, but there's this other side too that they don't see so much. And from my own experience, I know when I put up the occasional glimpses of that life on social media, people actually respond to that a lot better than they do the poker stuff, which can get a little bit samey, I won this tournament, I won that tournament, or I didn't cash this last 14 tournaments or whatever. It's more or less the same thing over and over again. So I think people, it's a side of poker which isn't covered very often, but it is certainly something that people are fascinated by when they are exposed to it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, look, time for our second clip now. This one features Dara, actually, who is being interviewed about Neil in the Bonington Hotel during the UK IPT Dublin 2022. Actually, that's the same one where we took silver in the beer pong, Dara. So yeah, for context, maybe
Just in
Dara's
case
actually
anyone's
hungover as
forgotten that.
well.
Yeah. Nice of you to wedge in your biggest poker achievement as well at the same time. Neil was talking earlier about game theory and so on. Like, that's just always where my brain goes when I have to do anything. And when Greg asked me to be in to do an interview, I asked him how many people he'd interviewed, and it was quite a large number. And I immediately thought, well, like, my chances of actually getting into this into this documentary are very, very low. I'm going to be one of the least recognizable people to a mass audience. So so my best strategy is clearly just to talk about how brilliant Neil is and how
We got him. You see, that actually was 4D chess because that's what I thought you'd think.
yeah.
That's what. So it was actually, I was pulling the strings from behind the scene the whole time.
Yeah,
Let's go.
but all joking aside, I mean, I was completely honest in my assessment of Neil. I've always had huge admiration for Neil, and I think he's a quite misunderstood figure in poker. People just think he's this sort of natural drunken genius who wanders around in a drunken haze, but he's such a genius, he's able to do everything. But I know from rare pieces of interaction with Neil, and also interviews with Thinking Poker and people like that, that he was one of the earliest guys thinking about the game in what I would call the modern way. And that's really stood him in good stead. So that's what I was trying to get across basically in that piece.
Well, let's see if you did. Here's that clip.
They go on what we call a heater, which means they run really well for a while and they do really well. And they're going around thinking, I'm a great poker player. And you're looking at the way they're playing and you think, you're not really that good, mate. You're just being very, very lucky. And then they do inevitably crash and burn. You're playing the long term. It doesn't matter what matters in any individual day. If you're a good player, you're going to make money in the long term. And Just don't focus on the short arm.
A stick ought to be out. Here it is. We're back in the game.
2 years ago, I was asked who the best player I'd ever played with, and I thought about it for a while, and I actually nominated Niall, because I think Niall is a complete player. He can play the big stack really well, he can put the pressure on, he can finish tournaments, he reads people really well, he manipulates them really well.
Tell us what you've got, but you can't tell us what you've got then, take ages. Come on.
He's very funny at the table, and people relax because of that, and when people are relaxed, they give away more information than when they're tense. So he's a master of that stuff. He's also a master of appearing to be very, very drunk, but still actually playing perfectly.
I don't think it's a clever act of being drunk. He is actually.
He's actually drunk. No, there's no doubt. He's drunk. But he's the player who can play the best drunk, in my experience. It just doesn't affect his play at all.
Okay, Dara, so I'll start with you this time, seeing as you were just talking on screen. You talked there in the clip about Niall's poker talent, obviously blamassing him massively, as you told us you would. I know you battled against him a lot online, as did I, but there is one memorable encounter, probably the first time you ever played against each other actually live, that comes to mind. Darren, are you remembering what I'm remembering?
Yeah, I was struggling there for a minute, but I do remember it. I battled against Niall online for years, and then I found myself at the same table in the Isle of Man at a UK IPT. Dominic Nietzsche was there as well. And I obviously knew who the two of them were, but I was pretty sure they hadn't any clue who I was. I just looked like a businessman who'd wandered in off the street, from whatever people do in the Isle of Man. And it definitely worked out to my advantage. So when I got back to my hotel room, I just sent Niall a message. I don't know if he remembers, but he was like, oh, fuck yeah, that was you, really?
Yeah, I do. I remember it well. This is how my memory works as well. Like, I'm going to go out for a couple of beers later on and watch the horse racing. First time in 3 weeks, by the way, I've been very good. But I'll go out and I'll, like, leave my jacket somewhere. But you asked me something that happened in a poker tournament in the Isle of Man 11 years ago. I'm like, oh, yeah, 10-8 of diamonds. Yeah, yeah, you know. Like, I don't know why that's how my brain works, but it is. So I do remember it very clearly.
And let me get this right, because I do want to give the audience a bit of a sense of how I think you were the two biggest stacks, and it was like the last level of the day. Because I know Dara ended up after this hand bagging up monstrously the biggest stack, and I think you got felted.
Yeah, I didn't have that biggest stack when I arrived at the table. At least that's my memory, but I could be wrong. But I do remember that essentially both Dominic and Niall gave me far too much respect. They respected my raises far too much. I mean, maybe they just had nothing as well. It was a case.
I think I made a big fold that's way out of line, and basically trying to mug off the old man at the table. then I realized it was Doke, and then therefore it was not a good fold. It might still have been by accident, but it was definitely very bad in theory. But I don't know if it was the main event or the Isle of Man Cup. Because, not to brag, because if it was the Isle of Man Cup, I won that tournament anyway.
Whoa. I was on the final table of the Isle of Man Cup with you, so I don't think it was that one.
No, it definitely wasn't the Isle of Man Cup. Yeah, I remember the Isle of Man Cup. You were incredibly drunk for day one of that, but you did bag up a big stack. It was definitely the main event, because I think it was the only time I've ever been chip leader in a main event.
Yeah, because I remember it very specifically. You had bossed everybody while drunk the previous night. It got down to like 13 left, and then you didn't show up until the final table began.
Yeah, I needed a bit of a lie in after that one. It was because, like, I believe it was like Dickie P and who else was that? Dark haired Sunnigger. I can't remember. The whole table was just. I remember it being, this would just be like a really good pub lineup, like the whole final table. It was just like eight great lads that you just, and then they're like, shove a few pints out. I was like, aye, fuck it. You know, have a couple. So everyone had a few, and it was great crack. Honestly, I really loved that. So the only time I've ever been to the Isle of Man, but it was really enjoyable. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was a good spot. I remember thoroughly enjoying it. And I also remember, I didn't know you that well. If I'd known you well, obviously I would have texted you that you weren't there. But I remember not knowing you that well, thinking, this is great that he hasn't shown up. Hopefully he won't arrive until, like, his stack lines up.
Probably the best I've played all tournament, to be honest.
Well, Neil, when someone makes a documentary about you, you automatically become the person in the limelight. People say nice things about you like Dara did, whether they mean it or not. Does hearing that kind of stuff make you cringe, or do you actually like it?
No, I think I like it. You know, it's nice to, you know, you get both sides, obviously, you know, but I mean, I'm an overweight ginger guy from Scotland, you know, I've got a pretty thick skin, but no, like hearing the nice things from people like your peers is always nice, you know, especially in poker where it's like very much, you know, you don't always get what you deserve, you know, it's like results. And a lot of the kind of poker media is just based on who's running the best at the time. Like, oh, is this the new best player in the world? It's like, well, yeah. Maybe. How do we know? We don't fucking know, do we? Let's be honest. So, like, the real form of kind of... Because as human beings, we all seek validation. And for me, the strongest form of validation is people who I respect talking and saying nice things about you. So, it's it's absolutely, absolutely very nice to hear. Even if it's just to get on TV, you know?
Yeah. And since this... hasn't come out yet, and obviously we're recording this a little bit ahead of time, as has been revealed. Any apprehension or fear about how it might be received? Like, I suppose you are sort of laying yourself raw a bit here and putting yourself out there.
Yeah,
if people think you're a big tit, will that be like, oh no, or thick skin and all that?
Yeah, no, I think like watching yourself is always a bit cringe. One thing I did notice is I seem to walk like a fucking 1970s action man. Have I always done that? Like the one with no knee joints? Like, have I always had this funny walk? Like, or is it just since I put a bit of weight on? Or so that's not ideal, just walking about for an hour like I've shit myself. But apart from that, like, you know, I don't know. I think I had the kind of epiphany, like I used to really care what people said about me and stuff. And I think it's just getting older. I just don't give a fuck anymore, to be honest.
Not only is that really funny in and of itself, but now I'm going to the third clip, which opens on you walking.
What? Yeah, I like, what? I'm like, have I always done this? And Adita's like, yeah, a little bit. I'm like, why has no one told me this before? Honestly, it's like those, because I have, it's like one of those 70s action man with no knee joint, like just straight leg. Like, what? Like, apparently I've done this forever, so not ideal, but
yeah. I'm just really glad we can cut to this clip now so I can recover a little bit.
Like the Oscars of poker, kind of, it's all the famous people and they're all dressed up. They managed to get me dressed up as a 6-year schoolboy, which is the closest thing I had to formal attire.
Thanks.
Simon, buddy.
Been a while?
It's been a while.
How you been? You good?
Very good.
Feder completed poker about 5 years ago. She doesn't need to play anymore. Feder won like 50 million in about fucking 3 days. In Vegas, it's nice drinks, it's nice food, it's free, it's nice view of the strip, all like this. It's like you're just kind of glamorous, kind of party kind of thing. Not something I'm particularly used to, you know, grow up. There's no decent tanning tenants in the corner. And I'm looking forward to it a wee bit, but we'll see how I get on in 6 months, and I'm like, fuck this, man. Nah, I should be. The team here are really good, and I'm excited to talk with them. And my colleagues like this,
looking at it. Oh,
$250 Vegas deep stack. I got very drunk.
I made it. First time in your life, right?
Of course, no. Yeah. I mean, I'd never had alcohol before, which is why I think it made me drunk. Looking back to like being at uni, working at Carphone Warehouse, I'd play poker in the house with my pals when we didn't have enough money to go to the pub. Sit and look at those cards, then you fast forward maybe, what, 10 years? And here I am in fucking the top of Caesar's Palace, where Joe Lo hangs out, with supermodels and singers and that walking about, and me getting steaming for a laugh.
Well, this party came at the end of a fairly relentless schedule of huge field tournaments at the WSOP. Neil, you lost over 100k, I know, during that series, but you did bag a sponsorship deal with GG Poker at the end, hence you going to their fancy party. Before I ask you about your time at GG, I'm interested to know, did you feel additional pressure to produce some results for Greg and the documentary? I know what you said there earlier about how, you know, you couldn't promise it, you know, there's just variance and maybe, you know, he's just going to watch you brick for 6 months. But was there ever any spots, because you did go deep in quite a few tournaments, where you punted a little bit harder for the win knowing it would be good for the show?
Not really, to be honest. I'm quite, one thing I've always been good at is detaching my poker game from everything else that's going on, which I think is, it has shown up a lot over the years. In fact, like, I probably had my most personal life tumultuous years in the 2 years that I won a triple crown, which I'm not saying it's causality or anything, but I think in many ways I use poker as a kind of escape from that kind of stuff. So you're really focused on something. So in general, when I'm playing poker, I'm just playing poker. It's not, outside things don't really affect me at all, which I don't know if it's just a natural thing or just something I've learned over the years, but it's been very fortunate for me on that behalf, because it allows, I think there's been a lot of spots over the years where I've been able to pull the trigger in spots where other people haven't, and it's done a lot of, like, good. I mean, it's made me a lot of money, and because people made a lot of big folds to me in high pressure spots over the years. So that kind of stuff, I think I'm really good at separating, which is good. Obviously, like, you do want to do well and you want to give them some stuff to do, but I was like, the first thing I said to him was like, just like when he contacted me 3 years ago, it is now, well, was, listen, I can't guarantee anything in poker. You know, it could go anything. In Vegas, for example, we wanted to do a lot more footage in Vegas, and it was just, he's like, right, I'm coming in, and I'm like, I'm out again. Like, I'm already out. Like, don't bother. I'll maybe see you tomorrow. And then I'd play a tournament again at fucking 10 a.m. or whatever bullshit they had us doing. And then he'd be like, 11:30, he's like, right, how are you getting on? I'm like, I'm out, maybe tomorrow. You know, that happened for about a month. So eventually we ended up doing like, all right, we're going to have to, can you take a day off? I'm like, a day off from just fucking incinerating my money? Absolutely. How many days off do you want? And we'll go and do something. I was like, right, fine. So we got some footage from that. But no added pressure, no. I'm like, he wanted it to be the real, like, his thing is he wants it to be the real deal. He doesn't want a glamorized version. He doesn't want a cartoonized version. He wants, it's a proper nitty gritty, hopefully not nitty, I mean, you know, I'll play some hands, but a gritty documentary. Like, it's, if it went completely shite, then that's still footage. That's still what it is like, you know? And it's like, sure. You see the part, like, the part that I do cringe a bit when I'm sat in a fucking cafe in Monte Carlo bemoaning that I'd rather be working at Carl from Warehouse. That gave me a bit of cringe, to be honest. But that's how you feel after you've just got 16th with like 1.2 million at first. You know, you just, you're fucking nothing. You're not, your head's not screwed on properly. You're raging. So that kind of gave me a bit of cringe. But in general, it's like, no added pressure, I wouldn't say.
Sure. Dara, I'm conscious that this is a bit of a spoiler, but I think maybe he'd already spoiled it, so it doesn't matter. I think our audience will be fairly engaged with poker, so they probably already know a bit about Niall in the last few years anyway. But during the final days of the WSOP, Niall's offered a lucrative ambassadorial contract with GG Poker, a deal which would provide some guaranteed income for the year ahead. This moment gives the documentary that you don't always get what you want, but sometimes you get what you need ending for Niall's part of it anyway. Obviously, Dave's also involved, but for Niall's part of the story, that's what the vibe is. Do you think that worked nicely as a final act?
Yeah, I think it did work for nicely as a final act. And I think it fits in very nicely too with just the way the poker world has gone in general. Content has become far more important than it was. Somebody like Niall has always produced great humor, injected great humor into the poker world. And that has probably more to do with his persona and his standing within poker, or at least as much as his actual achievements, which are considerable as well. But that's basically what hooks people in. And that presumably was a large degree of why GG wanted to sponsor him. And, you know, a lot of the money does in poker now comes from revenue streams like that, as we know too, as shabby, dirty, washed up content creators. We have to squeeze all those options as well. And so I think it kind of unwittingly, it actually very, very accurately portrayed the way what poker has become now. It's not just a matter of, you know, it used to be so easy that if you knew the hand rankings and some very basic strategy, you could be more or less guaranteed very lucrative income. Now, you know, the general standard has risen so much, variance is a much bigger thing for us now. And that's another good thing which comes across in the documentary, just how big variance is, particularly over short live samples, that if you want to make your living in poker, you have to try and seek out other revenue streams.
Very sensible. And back to you, Niall, for my final couple of questions on this, actually. We saw you mingling there on the roof of Caesar's Palace with Fedor, Elky, Negreanu. Your deal was obviously newly minted at that point. How did you enjoy your time with GG Poker? Was the life of a sponsored pro all it was cracked up to be?
It was an experience, I'll say that. It kind of, a lot of it kind of reminded me why I got into poker in the first place, is to not really have to deal with that stuff. I met some good people through it, made some good friends. I'm really close with Robin Poker now, who's a great lad, who's I think doing stuff with Poker News now. It kind of reminded me, you know, there's a lot of stuff said and promises made that weren't kept and stuff like that. Maybe another show in a couple of years or something, we can go into that. But overall, you know, I really enjoyed the people I worked with, on a personal level. Met some cool people, got to do some cool stuff. I think the company and myself just didn't really align with what we were wanting to do and the scale we wanted to do and things like that. I just think it was maybe just not the right fit for either of us. And that is my pitch for Politician of the Year.
Very, very well negotiated through that slightly mean question, I guess, on my part, given I kind of knew that you would answer in that way. Niall, I wrote my article about the documentary and I said in it that through David Docherty's inclusion, we get a greater sense of maybe how poker is a hard way to make an easy living. You've enjoyed much more success, or at least up to that point and previously had enjoyed a lot more success than David had. He has periods of struggle, times when he's fallen in there in love with the game, I know. And from that perspective, we appreciate how the decision to play full-time poker is really fraught with danger for some people, at least. How did you feel about sharing the limelight with David, and what do you think his story arc brought to the doc?
I really liked David, and I really like, because you're right, it brought something kind of different, because I think it would be fair to say that I've probably ran a bit hotter in the start of my career than most people, and David was someone who probably was on the other side of that coin, you know. Yeah. And when I first watched the doc, I know kind of roughly my bits because I was fucking there for them, you know. So I was quite interested to see David's. And I have to say, I found myself at the end with a kind of cool runnings ending, where it was like David wins the Irish Open. I was like, yes, come on, son. You know, it was like quite enjoyable, you know. So it's great. And obviously, David's a great lad. Fantastic taste in football teams. And, you know, it was great. I think it's a really good, because it kind of shows, like, for example, like, I'm in like top 99 percentile for sun runners, especially the first start of my career. So it kind of shows a more kind of, this is what's going to happen if you're not super lucky. You know, you can still do it, but you're still grinding it out and stuff. But then he does hit like a few massive scores at the end. And it's like a kind of, you know, it's a good kind of story of determination and not giving up and stuff. So it was a, yeah, no, I really enjoyed David's part in it.
Yeah, no, it was really good. Dara, to bring you in quickly on this, actually, we've known David for his whole career. And I think what was very apparent to us was there were periods, you know, not that long ago, actually, where it seemed like he might give up the game, but grew a determination again, I think maybe 4 or 5 years ago, got in with a very good group, started studying a lot more. And I think before the Irish Open result and before that one again, I suppose he had that GUKPT in Luton. We did feel, I think you and I probably spoke about this, we did feel like he was on the cusp of something, having not enjoyed big success before. I think we'd have bet on him that he was going to, because he was sort of shaping all the right way. And I guess this documentary had the opportunity to capture that period of his career.
Yeah, we've obviously always had a lot of respect for David, and I'm not going to tell the story you always tell about the first time we hung out in Galway,
oh no, do tell it now.
Obviously, yeah. But leaving aside encounters in jacuzzis that make us sound something we're not, We've always had huge respect for David, and he's been a very deep thinker and also a very disciplined individual, it has to be said, and sort of thinks about poker the right way. It feels like he finally sort of added two components. Component number one, sort of systematic study rather than thinking about individual spots. And the second thing was just he started running at least at EV or probably above EV. We all know poker players like that, that we know in our heart are really, really good, but it just hasn't happened for them live because the sample size is just ridiculously short, ridiculously small. And David was certainly in that category until his recent Sun run. You know, people ask me about my, on a much smaller scale, very good start to the year. I'm currently top of the Irish Poker of the Year rankings. People say, what are you doing different? And I mean, the honest answer is really, I'm winning flips now. That's kind of the reality.
Yeah, poker is obviously, you know, a cruel mistress, and we're all at sea in that kind of all the waves of variance. And yeah, I think most people will just acknowledge that. Yeah, I was playing just as well back when I was bricking everything. Just it wasn't happening for me sometimes. Neil, final question, I promise, this time for you. What was it like working with Greg? He's obviously BAFTA award-winning documentarian. You getting to work with someone of his caliber in the creative sphere. I imagine he's somebody you'll stay in touch with as well, because, you know, having seen you guys together at so many stops during that 6 month period, it did seem like you'd grown a bit of a bond. What could you say about him and I suppose that working relationship?
Yeah, it was really enjoyable. Obviously, when you're in each other's pockets for what was essentially 9 months or a little bit over, you do get some instances when you're like both of us are just alone. Can you just like fuck off for a day? Like, you know, but on both sides, to be fair, on both sides, because I imagine Christ, me being like having to deal with me every day for God knows how long I think I would drive me mental. So I don't know how I would do anyone else. But what I found was quite funny was despite we're in different, wildly different careers, we're very similar in a lot of ways. I remember we went and filmed, we did like an hour of filming on the bridge in Prague, and then after the hour of filming, Greg goes, ah fuck, I didn't have the battery in the camcorder. So <we're> just... But I'm like, I could be mad, but I'm like, that's exactly something that I would do, you know. So I can't just, you just laugh it off, you know. He was very much kind of like very similar kind of, I think it's like a little Venn diagram of like this kind of free spirit, like being a freelance documentary maker and being a poker player. It's not the rat race. It's not a 9 to 5. And I think there are certain characteristics that draw people to that. And I think a lot of them is that kind of head in the clouds. Sometimes, you know, you're just kind of, the amount of times, like we went out for a few beers in Prague and Greg just left, and I fucking hope BBC's not watching this, but Greg just left his camera and stuff in the pub. We had to go back and find it out later on and stuff like that. So there was a overall it was great. Good friends now, chat to him a lot on text. Sadly a Rangers fan, so a lot of it is abuse, but you know, that's just the way the cookie crumbles sometimes. But no, it was great to see, get to see behind the veil, you know, and hopefully we know where I'm on the invites list for the BAFTAs and stuff this year. I'm ready to embarrass some real fucking celebrities. Let's go.
Well, look, I really cannot recommend this documentary enough. A reminder that the Four Rules of the Poker Kings will be on the BBC iPlayer for a year. I believe it's dropping on BBC Scotland as well. Neil is a natural on screen, and David's story adds another fascinating dimension to, I suppose, the overall story being that of two of Scotland's finest. A huge thank you to Greg Clark for giving us an advanced screening, giving us those clips that you watched and letting us do a special episode on his documentary. We have no doubt it's going to be a really big hit. On that note, it remains for me to thank our guest this week. He is a household name, surely, at this point. Niall Farrell.
Thank you. Household name in my own house.
And Darragh O'Kearney, thank you as always.
Thanks, David. And yeah, big thanks to Neil. So many happy memories from Neil, with Neil down the years in poker. A lot of surprisingly large number of my happiest memories involved Neil in some way or other.
Say that to all the fish, I bet.
Take care, everyone.
Cheers. See ya.